So I welcome to you .NET Tricks, .NET Core training program. I will tell you about the .NET Core, how it is different from the existing .NET Framework 4.x. Then we talk about the ASP.NET Core and how it is different from the ASP.NET MVC 5. Then we talk about how we can create our ASP.NET Core project using Visual Studio. So let's first of all understand the .NET platform and the .NET Core. So my name is Shalin Chauhan. I'm Microsoft MVP, founder and CEO of .NETX. I'm having more than 11 years of experience. So this is about me in brief. So let's start with the history of .NET platform. So you already know the .NET we have been in the market from 2002. Then we having the Mono. So very few people heard about the Mono. So Mono is another extension of .NET which can run apart from the Windows machine. If you know about the Xamarin, so Xamarin is actually based upon the Mono for building the cross-platform mobile application. So with Xamarin we use Mono. Then we have here .NET 2.0, .NET 3.5, .NET 4.0, .NET 4.5, and starting from 2016 Microsoft introduced a cross-platform version of .NET, that is .NET Core. So now the .NET Core you can run on Windows, Mac, Linux, and Ubuntu machine also. Because the so far .NET framework, we can run only on Windows machine. We cannot run it in on Linux and any other machine over there. And the latest version of .NET Core is 3.1, but already Microsoft announced the .NET 5. So .NET 5 will release in November 2020. Even already we having the .NET 5 preview release. If you're willing to experience the .NET 5, so preview version like .NET 5 preview stick you can download and you can start experiences it here. So this is about the brief history of the .NET platform. So let's go ahead. So if you look at here, the .NET, so .NET is a development platform for building the web application, services, and the mobile application. So all the type of application we can build using the .NET 4.x. And the .NET having the CLR, and we having the .NET framework class library that support an extensive range of technologies like WCF, WPF, ASP.NET Web Form. So what is type of technologies available there? But the .NET we can run only on Windows machine. So latest version of .NET is here .NET 4.8. If you will look at the old .NET, so latest version we have been here .NET 4.8 here simply. So now we having here the .NET Core also. So if you look at the .NET Core, so .NET Core is a modular and the smaller implementation of .NET. So instead of having everything in single assembly, like in a single package, now they just make the .NET Core as modular. A .NET Core is cross-platform and open source, which you can run on Windows, Linux, and Mac machine. Even you can do the .NET Core element from any machine. You don't need to have the Windows machine. Using the Mac also you can build the .NET Core application. Even using the Linux machine also you can build the .NET Core application. It is having the container support. You heard about the Docker and the Kubernetes. So the Docker image we can create using the .NET Core. So if you're willing to develop a microservices using the Docker and the Kubernetes, so those application can be designed using the .NET Core. Here I'm not saying like .NET framework you cannot use for building the container based application, the microservice based application. There also the things are supported, but here you will get the better performance. So performance wise and the flexibility wise, .NET Core is far better than existing .NET framework 4.x here simply. So .NET Core support the container, .NET Core having the microservices architecture support also. And It is actually optimized for the high performance and scalability. So this is the main difference between the .NET and the .NET Core. If you're looking for the good performance and highly optimized application, there you should go for the .NET Core. So performance wise, there is a huge gap between the .NET Framework 4.x and the .NET Core. Even we having the cross-platform development tools also, like VS Code. I hope you heard about the VS Code. It is a great IDE for building the cross-platform .NET Core application, even to build the JavaScript-based application also. We having the .NET CLI also. So using the command language interface, you can also build, run, and debug your .NET Core application using Windows, Linux, and Mac machine. So these are the cross-platform development tools, because for building the .NET Core application, it is not mandatory. You have to install the Visual Studio on your machine. Using the VS Code and .NET CLI, the entire .NET Core application you can build from start to end. And this is the point here I mentioned, like in couple of years, .NET Core will replace everywhere. Even this year, starting from November 2020, now Microsoft is going to put the .NET Core, whether it's a mobile application, whether it's a Windows application, a machine learning, IoT application, everywhere you will find out Microsoft replaced the .NET Core. So if you are comparing the .NET platform, like how the things are looking right now, you can see we having a .NET framework where you having the support for WPF, Windows Forms, ASP.NET, base class library. Then we having the .NET Core with ASP.NET Core, UWP support, and other support here. Then we having the Xamarin for building the cross-platform mobile application. So these are the different three implementation we having for .NET. So first is a .NET Framework 4.x, then we .NET Core, then we having Mono. Now these are the set of tools you can use for building the .NET Core and Mono based application. Now let's quickly move to the .NET Core 3.0 architecture, how it is looking like. So starting from .NET Core 3.0, we having the support for desktop application. So if you're willing to use the WPF and the WinForm application for building the desktop application to target the Windows machine, in .NET Core you can build. Even you can build the IoT application and machine learning and AI application also. So this is the .NET Core 3.0 architecture we have. If you look at the .NET 5, so this is the .NET 5 architecture if you look at. So starting from .NET 5, Microsoft is going to use everywhere .NET Core to build your desktop, web application, cloud application, mobile application, to build the games, to build the IoT application, to build the machine learning and AI application also. So this is the architecture we having for the .NET 5. So .NET 5 is actually .NET Core. So Microsoft is not going to release the .NET Core 4.0, because we already having the .NET Framework 4.x. That is the widely used version of .NET. So that's why they're skipping the .NET Core 4.0 release. They are directly releasing the .NET Core 5.0. But to .NET Core 5.0, they are not calling it Core. Now JS, they are just giving the common name .NET 5. So .NET 5 is actually .NET Core 4.0 actually, where they are going to unify all the type of technologies to build the application on the top of .NET Core. So .NET 5 is actually .NET Core 4.0. And here you can see we having the Visual Studio for Mac. We having the VS Code and the command language interface. So these are the things we are having over here. So .NET 5 is a unified platform for building all the type of application. And RTMA will release in November 2020. Right now it is available in preview. And recently Microsoft announced the .NET 6.0 also. So last week we having the .NET build. It is a Microsoft Build Conference every year they are having. So there they announce the .NET 6.0 also. So in the .NET 6.0, they are going to introduce a one more framework, MAUI, for building the cross-platform desktop application, mobile application, by targeting this new framework. So now instead of Xamarin Forms, they are coming with a new framework, MAUI, for building the cross-platform mobile application, desktop application. So this is about the .NET. This is about the Microsoft 2020 build event. I just told you here what the new things they introduce over there. Okay, now let's proceed here. Guys, here the today's session might be looking to you the theory, because my objective about today's session is, first you should understand why you should learn the .NET Core, what is .NET 5, and what is going on. We will do the hands-on as well, but please wait. Because until I will not cover these basic fundamental things, you are not going to understand what is the need to learn the .NET Core. Otherwise, you will think about it's having the same set of things as we already know, as we already building the application. So these things are necessary to understand before doing the hands-on into the .NET Core. Okay, now let's proceed here. So when you're talking about the .NET standard, so .NET standard is a set of APIs which is actually helping us to share the code between the different implementation of .NET. Because what is happening, let's say you're having an application in .NET framework 4.x and you are having a new project which are going to target their .NET Core. So now you're willing to share the existing business logic with your new .NET Core application. So it can be shared through the .NET standard. So just target your library to .NET standard. So .NET standard is a way to share the code between your .NET framework 4.x application, between your .NET Core application, and even between your Xamarin application also. So this is a common standard for code sharing. And now let's proceed here further. What the .NET Core 3.0 does not support. So it does not support here web forms. Even they don't have any plan to support the web forms, ASMX services, WCF, WWF, link to SQL. So these things are not supported in .NET Core 3.0. Even they don't have any plan to support in 5.0 and the 6.0 also. It means in .NET Core, you cannot build these application now. WPF, they already support in .NET Core 3.0. WinForm also, they already support in .NET Core 3.0. But they don't have any plan to support all these things. Now we having only Razor syntax to build the UI on the top of .NET Core. Okay, now let's proceed further. So when you're talking about the .NET compilation, so this is the traditional .NET framework 4.x compilation, where we having the F# compiler, C# compiler, and VB.NET compiler for compiling the code, and then we having the intermediate language code, and you can use the framework class library, then through the CLR you can generate the machine level code. But if the same thing, if you look at the .NET Core, so in .NET Core, we having the same thing. The difference is here, we now having a common compiler, that is Roslyn. So in .NET Core, we are going to use Roslyn compiler for compiling our C# and VB.NET Core. So the step by it is same, but under the line, they just replace the compiler, they just replace the runtime also. So when you're talking about the Roslyn, so Roslyn is a new .NET compiler platform, which is based upon compiler as a service concept. It is open source compiler where you can run the C# code, Visual Basic code, and even it having the same set of APIs which Microsoft already using in Visual Studio. Now let's have a look at the Core CLR. So Core CLR is a runtime implementation of .NET Core. It is similar to the CLR, but difference between CLR and the Core CLR is Core CLR is cross-platform. So it can run on Windows, Mac, and the Linux. But the CLR you can run only on Windows machine. You cannot run it on the Mac and the Linux. So this is the difference between the core CLR and the CLR. And here in place of ZIT compiler, because in .NET Framework 4.x we use ZIT compiler. Here we using the ReuseIt compiler. So ReuseIt compiler is the next generation ZIT compiler for .NET Core. It support high performance ZIT architecture focused on high throughput and ZIT compilation. So performance wise, ReuseIt is very fast. So application will start 30% more fast as compared to the existing .NET framework 4.x. Now let's understand here .NET CLI. That is very important here when you are learning the .NET Core. So .NET CLI is a tool chain for building, developing and publishing the .NET Core based application. So when you are using the Linux, when you are using the Ubuntu or like Mac machine, there people prefer the .NET CLI to create their .NET Core application, to build the application, to debug the code also. So it support various commands. It support the installation of NuGet packages, and it is a cross-platform tool. So if you are following the .NET CLI, so it doesn't mean whether you are using Mac, Windows, and the Linux. Everywhere by following the same style and the same set of commands, you can build the .NET Core application. Even the same example I will show you here, how we can use the .NET CLI. So these are set of commands we can use here for .NET CLI. Like .NET new is a command to create the new project. .NET restore is a command to restore all the NuGet packages. .NET run is a command to compile the code and run my .NET Core application. .NET build is only to build the code. It will not run the application. The .NET build native if you are willing to create a single exe from your code. Even you can define your set of command also, it's up to you. So here I will use a .NET CLI. So when you are using the .NET new is a command to create new project, .NET build for compiling the code, .NET restore for restoring all the NuGet packages, .NET run for running the code here. So this is a complete flow you will find out when you are using the .NET CLI. Now let's get started with the .NET Core with the help of .NET CLI. So let me show you here what are the things you need to have to get started with .NET Core. So make sure you have installed the .NET Core SDK. So .NET Core SDK you need to download from the official website of .NET. So we having the .NET Core 3.1. So this SDK can be downloaded from here. So depending upon the operating system, whether it's a Linux, Mac, and Windows, you can download the package. You can download the SDK here. So I'm using here Windows machine. So this package I have already installed. I can verify it by using the CMD. You can verify the install package. So I'm just using here the CMD to verify the package here. So what I'm doing here, I'm just going to verify the install version of .NET. So it is going to show me here .NET space test version. So you can see here on my local machine, I'm having the .NET Core 3.1.201. So this is the install version of .NET Core I'm having here. So after installing the .NET Core SDK, you will get this version by running this command. Now for as an IDE, I suggest you here you should use the Visual Studio Code. So just go to here code.visualstudio.com. From here, you can download the VS Code IDE. That is a cross-platform IDE available for Windows, Mac, and the Linux. So anywhere you can install it and start building your .NET Core application here simply. So these are the two tools I'm just going to use over here to get the things about it. Okay, so what I'm doing here, I'm just going to find out what are the various template I'm having on my machine. So just use your .NET new. dash l. So it will show us the list of available templates which I can use to create different types of .NET Core application. So you can see I'm having a template for my console application, and the short name is here console. I can create a class library. I can create here WPF application. I can create here a Razor application, ASP.NET Core, Angular application. So these are the available template you can use with .NET CLI to create the different types of application. So from here, what I'm doing here, I'm just going to create a console application. So what I'm doing here, I'm just going to create a console application in my C drive. So I can look at what are the various folder I'm having in my C drive. In my C drive, I'm having a folder for weekdays and the weekend. So what I'm doing here in this code folder, I'm just going to create a .NET Core application. You can use UI also, but here I'm just showing you the .NET CLI way. I will show you the Visual Studio way also, but I'm just showing how you can use the .NET CLI if you're using the Linux and any other machine. So I'm just going to create here my console application .NET new. Then application type is here console. Define your project name. So project name would be here, let's say my app. So I'm just going to create a console application with the name my app. So my app would be here a console application. If you want to check what is the part of my app folder, now I can look at in my app folder. So you can see in the my app folder, I'm having a program.cs file. I'm having this obj folder. I'm having here my app.cs project over here. So what I can do here, I can open the VS Code at this folder location. So just open this folder in your C drive, and there let me open the VS Code. So this is my code folder and this is my app. I just do right click, I can open this folder in my VS Code. So VS Code is a cross platform IDE which you can use. And if you look at in the VS Code, I can see I'm having a program.cs file now containing the hello world. Simply now what we can do here, through the command prompt I can build this code itself. So using the .NET build command I can build my code. So .NET build, so .NET build command build the code. If there is any error, it will show us. Simply it is building my code. So can see here it, the build has been succeeded. There are zero warning, zero error. Now I can run the code .NET run. And when you will use the command .NET run, it will show me the output. So I can see I'm getting here hello world as an output. Because in my code, this is the hello world output I'm having. Okay, let me open that folder here again, like my app. So this is the folder where we having this console application here. But today I'm not here to teach you the console application. Let's start with creating our ASP.NET Core application, because here we are just going to create a console application. The similar project we can create using Visual Studio also, I'm not denying, but I'm just showing you here .NET CLI way, because the Visual Studio way is simple, straightforward, you can create it. So what I'm doing here, let's create here a console application, sorry, a ASP.NET Core application. So what I will do here, I will create here a ASP.NET Core application using my command prompt. So cd code, and let me create here a ASP.NET Core application. .NET new MVC, and then name. So my ASP.NET app. So this would be my project name. So I'm just creating here a ASP.NET Core application. So this has been created here, and this is my project name, my ASP.NET app. So now this project I can open using my VS Code. It is my ASP.NET app. Let me open using the VS Code. So you can see here, using the .NET CLI, we created our ASP.NET MVC project. And here you can see we having the controller, we having the models, we having the views, because here we are following the MVC pattern. And here, if you look at, we having a program.cs file. If you know about the ASP.NET web form, in the ASP.NET web form, we having over there a global.asx file, we having over there web.config file, but here we don't have such file over there, because ASP.NET Core is a typical console application. It start from public static void main. You can see it is a public static void main, which it is showing to us here. So what I can do here, through my Visual Studio, I can build my code and start using it. So let me disable this extension. It is creating the issue. So instead of using this command prompt, what I can do using the VS Code itself, you can build your application. In the VS Code, we having a terminal, then use the option new terminal. So the same command prompt, it's open inside my VS Code itself. So now here I can run the command .NET build to build my code. So first we are building the code to verify everything is working fine over here. It's working fine. Now run the code .NET run is a command to run my code. So it automatically run my .NET Core application, and you can see by default it's running on the port number 5001. So here it is my ASP.NET application that is running on this port number. So perfectly it's working fine. So this is the VS Code and the .NET CLI way to create my ASP.NET Core application and to run it. Even the same thing I can create using my Visual Studio also. If you don't like this way, so what you can do, you can similar way create the project using your Visual Studio also. So for this one, you need to install here Visual Studio 2019. So just download here Visual Studio 2019 from the official website. So this is the Visual Studio official website. From here you can download the Visual Studio 2019, and please download the community edition. So here community edition is free to use for personal purpose. You don't need to pay anything, and it is having the same set of features as are available in the professional edition. So just use here community edition to build your .NET Core application. Even the Visual Studio is available for Mac also. So you can download the Visual Studio for Mac, but here I'm using a Visual Studio for Windows machine. That's simple. .NET CLI you cannot use for the previous version of .NET application. It is available only from .NET Core. So I'm just using a Visual Studio to create my ASP.NET Core application. So this is my Visual Studio where I'm just going to create my ASP.NET Core application. So what you can do here, you can create a new project here by clicking the option create a new project. And then here you can make a search for C sharp language, then platform here Windows, then we having the all project type. So you can see I'm having a project type here, ASP.NET Core Web Application. And here also you can do search for MVC. You can see I'm having ASP.NET Core Web Application. Click on the next button. Then you can define the project name. So let's say project name is here, ASP.NET MVC app. Then define a location where you are willing to save the project. So let's say I'm willing to save the project here on code, and this is my, let's say, a weekdays I'm just using over here. Now let's click on the create button to create the project here simply. And here these are the available templates here in my Visual Studio to create different types of .NET Core application. So here we having the empty template, we having a template to create the API. If you're willing to create the REST API, this template you can select. We having a template to create the web application over here. Then here we having the web application, we having the MVC, we having the Angular, we having the React.js and the Redux. So these various templates are available. So one of them you can use over here. So what I'm doing here, I'm just going to use here MVC template to create my ASP.NET Core application. So select here MVC template and do the things over here. So this is the MVC template, and here you can configure it for HTTPS also. Because nowadays what is happening is a recommendation, your website should support HTTPS. So that's why I'm using here HTTPS. Then click on the create button to create my ASP.NET Core application. So this is having the similar style as we have in Visual Studio 2017 to create my ASP.NET MVC5 application. So similar way, I just created here the ASP.NET Core application also here. Okay, so this is the way how we created our ASP.NET Core application, and it is having the same folder structure as it is created by the .NET CLI. So here, before understanding this folder structure, let me explain about the ASP.NET Core. What is ASP.NET Core and how it is different from the existing ASP.NET MVC5? So that thing I'm just going to tell you here in this PPT. So now let's proceed to understand the ASP.NET Core. So first of all, let's understand how the ASP.NET Core has been evolved. So you know, initially Microsoft came with the classic ASP for building the website. Later on, Microsoft introduced the ASP.NET Web Forms for building the web application by following the code behind model. Then we having the ASP.NET MVC. So we having MVC 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 for building the web application using the MVC pattern. At the same time, Microsoft introduced the web pages for building the smaller website. So web pages first time came with MVC 3. Then we having the web API. So web API they introduced with MVC 4 for building the REST API. So instead of using the WCF REST, now you can use the ASP.NET Web API for building your REST API. So what they did in the ASP.NET Web API, they just clubbed the ASP.NET framework features with the WCF REST kit and created a new framework, ASP.NET Web API, for building the REST API. If you will look at the ASP.NET Core, so initially when the ASP.NET Core came in the picture, they given the name as MVC6, but MVC6 was not the valid name. Soon they realized, because MVC6 giving you the feel like my existing ASP.NET MVC5 application can be upgraded to the MVC6 with doing few minor changes, but it was not that. it's not a upgradation, it's a migration. So there is a difference between upgradation and migration. In upgradation, after doing the few changes, the application can be upgraded to the higher version. But in migration, you need to change a lot of things. That's a complete change, in fact, sometimes. So it's a migration, it's not upgradation. So that's why they rename it as ASP.NET Core. That is a perfect name for the MVC 6. So ASP.NET Core, it is a unified version of MVC, Web API, and Web Pages. So when you are saying, I know ASP.NET Core, it's mean you know how to build the UI, how to build the API, and how to build the Web Pages also. But in ASP.NET MVC 5, we having the different style, we having the different life cycle, we having the different set of DLL also. Even in Web Pages, the same thing was there in Web API also. But starting from the ASP.NET Core, now we having the same set of DLLs, same life cycle, same set of events. So nothing is changed here. So this is the change in ASP.NET Core from the existing MVC 5 and ASP.NET Core Web API should know. Now let's have a look at the ASP.NET Core 2.2 architecture. So this is the picture here, how the ASP.NET Core 2.2 is looking over here. If you look at here, the ASP.NET Core 2.x application you can build, even you can host on the top of .NET Framework 4.6 plus. But the same thing they change in ASP.NET Core 3.0. Starting from ASP.NET Core 3.0, now the ASP.NET Core 3.0 application will target only .NET Core. You cannot run ASP.NET Core 3.x application on the top of .NET Framework. And even they added the support for ML, AI, and IoT based application also. Even now we have the support for WPF and WinForms also. But the WPF and the WinForms you can use for building the desktop application to target Windows machine. That means you cannot target the Mac OS and the Ubuntu or like Linux to build the desktop application. So WPF and the WinForms are still to target the Windows, not the Mac and others. So this is the thing you should know. But in Microsoft Build, they announced they are coming with the new framework, MAUI, to create the cross-platform desktop application. So starting from .NET 6, you can build the cross-platform desktop application using the MAUI framework. That is a new framework Microsoft is building, and they will release in 2021. So 2021 will come next year. So, but let's talk about what is happening in the current. So this is about the ASP.NET Core 3.0 architecture. You should know over here. Now let's understand how the ASP.NET Core is different from the existing ASP.NET MVC 5. So it is open source and the cross-platform framework. It can run on the top of .NET framework, even on the top of .NET Core also. It is a unified framework for building the UI and the APIs. It is having a built-in support for dependency injection. So we don't need to install a separate library as we need to install in existing ASP.NET MVC 5 application to implement the DI. Here it's having the built-in support. We having a new lightweight and modular HTTP request pipeline. It ships entirely as a NuGet packages. It is having a built-in support for single page application. So if you are willing to build the Angular, Vue, and the React.js application, you can easily build using the ASP.NET Core. So these are the features are available in ASP.NET Core. And it is well suited for building the cloud-based application like web app, mobile backends, IoT application, machine learning, and AI-based project. You can build using the .NET Core. And if you will compare the performance of ASP.NET Core with existing ASP.NET framework, so there is a huge gap between the performance. It is 2300% difference. So the ASP.NET Core application can serve 2300% more requests per second as compared to the ASP.NET framework 4.6. So it is a huge difference, not 23%, it's 2300%. And if you will compare the performance of .NET Core with the other competitors like Java, Node.js and the PHP, so ASP.NET Core is very fast as compared to this framework also. This is the benchmark. So higher is better here. So there is a huge difference in the performance of ASP.NET Core with others competitors also. So that's why the people are now using the ASP.NET Core, even they are migrating their existing application to ASP.NET Core so that they can take the benefit of .NET Core performance. Even recently we migrate our .NETX.com website to .NET Core. So initially we made the .NETX using the ASP.NET MVC5, AngularJS and the React. Now we migrated our .NETX to .NET Core 3.1 and we find out over there a huge difference in terms of performance. So now the navigation is very smooth as it was before, because before it takes a lot of time in migration. Even when we provide the release also, it was quite time taking, but now performance wise is very good now after migrating to the .NET Core 3.1. So this is a real experience I'm just telling you. Similar experience you will find out in Stack Overflow also. Stack Overflow was based upon the .NET framework 4.x. Now what they did, they migrated the Stack Overflow code to the .NET Core 3.1. After that, they find out a huge difference in the performance of Stack Overflow also. The similar story we having for Bing also. So Bing.com is from Microsoft. It is also built with .NET framework 4.x. So they also migrated the Bing to the .NET Core. And there also they find a huge difference in the performance. So these are the few live example I have just given you. One from .NETX, second one is from Stack Overflow, and third one is from Bing.com. So when you will migrate your existing application to the .NET Core, you will find out the huge difference in the performance. So let's understand here how the ASP.NET Core application looks like. So here everything is start from the program.cs file in the main method, and here we having a startup class, and here you will not find any global.asx, no web.config file, there is no module and handler, and even it's not having any dependency on the IIS web server. Here we use Castle web server. So Castle is a cross-platform web server which can be used to host your application on Linux and Windows machine. So you don't need to have now IIS, because the MVC5 and the ASP.NET web application we deployed using the IIS web server. But here it can be Nginx, it can be Apache Tomcat, it can be IIS. Anywhere you can deploy your code here. So I'm not going to cover here. Let's directly look at the request processing of ASP.NET and the ASP.NET Core. If you using the MVC5 like ASP.NET web form, so the request flow for the application look like this way. So here the request and response would be prepared by the IIS web server, because such application we can deploy only on Windows machine. And Windows, we use IIS web server over there. But starting from the .NET Core, you don't need IIS. You can use Apache Tomcat, you can use Nginx, any web server you can use. Because IIS and Nginx are here acting as a reverse proxy server. It means they just receive the request, they don't process it. So what are the the request they are receiving, they delegate it to the internal Kestrel web server. So this internal Kestrel web server is actually responsible to process the request and prepare the response. And finally, whatever the response is prepared, it returned to the client through the Nginx, like through the Apache and through the IIS here. So here, there are two web servers involved in this picture. So the one web server is here for receiving the request and delegate to the internal Kestrel web server. So here, IIS, Apache and Nginx are not processing the request and not preparing the response. It is done by the internally Kestrel web server. So this is the difference here in ASP.NET Core request pipeline from the existing ASP.NET web form and existing ASP.NET MVC 5 over here. So this is about the request pipeline I just told you here. Now let's understand here the ASP.NET Core folder structure. Now I hope you having the clarity how the ASP.NET Core is different from the ASP.NET MVC 5, how the flow here has been changed. Now let me quickly compare here MVC 5 with ASP.NET Core. I'm just giving the permission to chat. Can you confirm here how many people are aware of MVC 5? You can give your answer through the chat window. I have given the permission. Okay, that's good. So if you already know the MVC 5, you can find out here the things are easy. Because whatever the MVC 5 understanding you are having, the same understanding can be used with ASP.NET Core MVC also. Let me share here the differences between the MVC 5 and ASP.NET Core. And these differences are actually you should know in fact. Whenever you are migrating your existing MVC 5 application to ASP.NET Core, until you don't know these differences, so it would be difficult for you to migrate your existing MVC 5 application to MVC Core. So now let's have a look here. So in ASP.NET MVC 5, we having the HTML helpers, which we use to create the HTML forms. In ASP.NET Core, we having the tag helpers, we having the HTML helpers. So they still having the support for HTML helpers, because it can be the case you are migrating the MVC 5 UI to the ASP.NET Core. So you don't need to do so much changes at the UI side, because the existing HTML helpers they are supporting. Only WebGrid they are not supporting. If you are having a WebGrid in your MVC 5 for the listing purpose, so that WebGrid here is not supported. For WebGrid, you need to find out the other alternative. Otherwise, other HTML helpers are, it is supporting as it is. Even they introduce a new style to create the form, that is tag helper. Even in ASP.NET Core MVC, you should use the tag helper for designing the UI. So here, so many people think about why we should use tag helper. So tag helper, actually, when you will use, it is a user friendly. Even you don't need to do so many changes. Whatever the wireframe like design is given by the UI developer to you, or like given by the designer to you. You can easily integrate the Razor syntax over there, and you can start using it here. In MVC 5, we having the web form and the Razor syntaxes. In MVC Core, we having only Razor syntax. There is no support for the web form. In MVC 5, we having the partial view. In ASP.NET Core, we having the partial view as well as view component. Because you know, in MVC 5, we create two types of partial view: static partial view and dynamic partial view. So if you are willing to create here static partial view, you can here create using the partial view. For the dynamic, we having the view component. So dynamic partial view, we cannot create here in ASP.NET Core directly. We create here using the view component. And the example of dynamic partial view is here. Let's say you are willing to show the comments for an articles, or let's say you are willing to show the number of categories from the database. So there we use the dynamic partial view. So here in that case we use view components. Then and MVC 5 is a typical web application, but core is a typical console application. In MVC 5 we having the global.asx and the web.config file. In MVC core we having the startup.cs file, and we having the app settings.json. So just remember it here, in place of global.asx we use startup.cs file. So what are the settings you are defining in web.config? Here you need to define in app settings.json, like connection string, app key, and various the settings you can define here in app settings.json file simply. And here we having the modules and handler, but here we don't have modules and handler. In place of that we having the middleware, because the objective of modules and handler is to intercept the request and response and there inject your own logic. So similar thing here can be done using middleware. So middleware can be used to inject your custom logic whenever it is required. Then MVC 5 application we can host on IIS only, but here it's hosted through the Castel web server. That is a cross-platform web server. It runs only on Windows, but it runs only Mac, Linux, and Windows. Everywhere it can be run. So this table actually will clear the things how the ASP.NET Core is different from MVC 5. So many similarity you will find out over here, but the performance-wise it is better, and the configuration-wise it is different. So now let's understand here the ASP.NET Core folder structure. So as explained here, we having the startup.cs file where you can define all the settings which are required to configure at the application level. So here we having a method configure service method, and we having a method configure. So these two methods actually we use to add the services in your application, because I said in ASP.NET Core there is a built-in support for dependency injection. Even in ASP.NET Core by default everything is not enabled. Let's say session in ASP.NET Core is not enabled, but in ASP.NET web form it is enabled by default. In MVC 5 also it is enabled by default. So here if you are willing to enable the session, so that session service we need to add here. Let me show you here how we can enable the session here. Let's say services dot add session, it's services add session. So session I'm just going to enable here. So just I added the session as a dependency. So whatever the service I added here, this service I'm willing to use in my application. So here I need to call it here. So let me use here app dot use session this way. So this configure service method is used to add services to the container, because when you're talking about the dependency injection, there we having a container. So to the container we add all the dependency, and whenever that dependency we need to access, that container provide that dependency instance every time. So same thing is here. In this method we add the dependency, and in this method that dependency we configure so that we can use it with the HTTP request pipeline. So whatever the method you are willing to call, or like whenever you are making the request and response. So these are the actually middleware. So as we having the handler and module which actually used to intercept the request and response so that you can add your own code, similar way we having the middleware. So these are the middleware where we already added the few code which we are willing to add whenever you are making the request and when the response is going to process. Similarly, you can create here your custom middleware also, and you can inject it. So custom middleware example is, you can create a middleware for authentication purpose, and even you can create a middleware for authorization purpose also. So it's up to you. So this is about the configure service and configure method, which are used to enable the session here like any other service. So here you should add the dependency, and that middleware we need to add over here. It's simple. Then we having here a program.cs file that is containing a main method. So whenever you will run the application, so this main method is going to be used, where it will create the host for our application to host our ASP.NET Core application. So I said here it's not having any dependency on the Apache, Nginx, and the IIS web server. It having its own Kestrel web server. So that Kestrel web server setting is done over here. How to host the application? And when we are hosting it, we are just going to pass the startup class here. So whatever the settings we define in the startup class, those settings will be applicable to the application globally. So this is the way how we can start our server to host the application simply. So these are the two files we having here. Now if you will look at here in appsettings.json, which is the alternative to web.config, as we have in MVC5, as we have in ASP.NET web form. So here you can define the database connection history. You can define here any other configuration. Let me show you here one of the example. So you can define here the connection string like this way, connection strings, and here you can define the connection string value. So let me define here default connection, and here connection string value you can define here. So here you have to define your connection string. I'm not writing here, but you need to define here. Similar way you can define here app settings also, let's say API address. You can have, let's say, any other setting, let's say email host, then password for the email host, SMTP server details you can define over here. So what are the things we define in the app dot, in the web.config, or like in the app.config, we defining in this app settings.json. Now if you will look at, we having a controller folder, it is same here to define your controller. So in the controller we write our presentation logic. So whatever the activity a user is performing on the view page, so that activity we are just going to handle over here in this controller action. So this is my controller over here I added here. Then I'm having a model. So what are the views you are going to create? For the views, obviously you will create here view controls, let's say input control for taking the input from the end user. So here those things we can define simply. So guys, here now we can ask the question. I just mentioned the, just enable you the for the chat here. It's simple, and I will take your all the question in the last, don't worry. Just write down your question, I will give you the answer of queries whatever you will have in the last. Then we having over here the views folder. So here in the views folder, whatever the action we are having, so corresponding to action we having a view file. So we having here index file, we having here privacy file. So when you will run the code, so on the this index action will render this index page here simply. It's going to render this index page here, and when you will move to the privacy action, it will render the privacy page. So this is the way, this is the default mapping is happening. So here as per the default mapping, whatever the action name you are having, with the same name it will look for the view here simply. So same thing is happening. We having here index section. So corresponding to this index section, we are just going to render this index view. And we having a shared folder. In the shared folder, we define those views file, which are actually common to our application. Like we having the master view, we having the layout page, we having the common error page, we having the partial views, which we are going to use across the application. So whatever the files which are common to the application, we define in the shared folder here. So example is here layout, example is here error page, example is our partial view. Then we having here underscore view import file. So this underscore view import file, you should use whatever the namespaces, whatever the classes you are willing to use across the application views. So what is happening here on my view page? Obviously, I will use here view classes, I will use a view object. So those namespaces you should use over here. If you look at in the example, we added here the reference for the tag helper, so that on each view page I can use my tag helper. So here I can use my tag helper classes because the reference we added on this underscore view import file. We having here a underscore view start file also, which we are going to use to define the default layout for application. So whenever a view is going to be rendered in the browser, so what would be the default layout? So from here, the default layout can be set. Even here I can write the condition. So based upon the routing, I can decide which layout I am willing to render over here. So this is the folders and the file meanings I just explained to you here. And if you look at, we having here www root folder also. So what is the meaning of this folder? This folder we are using here to keep our static files. So you can see we having a CSS folder, we having a JS folder, we having a lib folder that is containing our Bootstrap library, jQuery library and others library. So what are the static files you are willing to serve in your application? Those files it should add over here. Even when I will create my own style sheet, when I will create my own JS file, I will add in this www root folder, because this www root folder is whitelist through this middleware app.use static files. So when you're using your app.use static files, there it's always enable the www root folder to serve the static files. Because here it is not like the MVC5 and web form, where from any folder you can serve the static files. In ASP.NET Core, if you are willing to serve the static files from a folder, that folder we need to make a whitelist. Same thing is happening here. So here www root folder is whitelist to serve all the static files over here. So this is the meaning of www root folder over here. So I explain here everything in this folder. Even if you look at, there is a one more file here, app settings.development.json. So what happens when we build a enterprise grade application? So obviously we need to provide the release for different environment. Let's say development environment, we having the testing environment, we having the staging environment, we having the production environment. So we need to create over there the environment specific settings. So those environment specific settings we can define here by creating here the environment specific file like app settings.development.json. Similar way, you can create here app settings.testing.json, app settings.staging.json. And specific to that environment, you can define the settings like connection string, your API address, your SMTP server details. So whatever you are willing to change as per the environment, you can define here in this environment file here. So this is the meaning of each file and folder in this ASP.NET Core application I explained to you. I hope now it is clear to you here. So now to run it here, simple, just click on this green button to run my ASP.NET Core application. It will start running. Simple. So it is running my code. Now let's have a look how it is showing. It will run in the similar way as we run it through the .NET CLI. It's running. It's showing the output. So guys, here for first day I have done from my side. Let me wrap the session for today class. Today first I started from the .NET Core. So there I explained the .NET platform history, how the .NET Core is different from the .NET framework. Then we talk about the Roslyn compiler, .NET CLI. Then we create the project using the .NET CLI. Then we run it using the VS Code. Then I tell you about the ASP.NET Core evolution history, how it is different from the existing ASP.NET MVC 5. What are the modules? What are the middleware here? And then I explain here the ASP.NET Core folder structure in the Visual Studio. So these things are necessary to know to get started with the ASP.NET Core. Okay, so let's create here ASP.NET Core 3.1 application. So I'm just using here new project, then define here another project. So here I'm selecting the template here ASP.NET Core web application. Using the C# language, we are going to create this project here. Click on the next button, then define the project name. Let's say ASP.NET app. And here you can define the location where you are willing to save it. So I'm using a desktop. Then it is here code, and we having the weekdays. Then click on the create button. Then you will find out we having the various templates. One of the template you can use to create the API, to create the UI, and to create the ASP.NET Core application using Angular as a front end and ASP.NET Core as a back end. So Angular thing we already did in the last session. So last week we did a session on learn Angular with ASP.NET Core. If you're willing to watch the recording of already held session on Angular with ASP.NET Core on the .NET Facebook page, it is available. Today let's create here MVC template. I'm using here to create my ASP.NET Core application. So here I've selected the MVC template where I will find out all the things set up for me to create a ASP.NET Core MVC application. So using the Visual Studio, the things are simple over here. For creating the ASP.NET Core 3.1 project, you need to install the Visual Studio 2019. In Visual Studio 2017, 3.1 is not supported. So here this is my project has been created. So when you're building any web application, for building any web application, we mainly deal with three things. We deal with data, we deal with logic, and we deal with the UI. And if you're willing to manage all these three things in your code, so how we can manage these three things in our code? We can manage these three things. So data we hold using the object, and the logic we write within a class. And UI is actually our DOM, document object model. So when you're building any web application, so we have to manage three things over there. Data you need to manage, logic you need to manage, and UI you need to manage. So how data we can hold? Data we can hold using the object, logic you can write within a class, and UI is actually document object model. So guys, here you might be thinking, what is the difference between the object and class? So let me tell you here in a simple language. So when you're talking about the object, so object are the real world entity. So the real world entity can be understood with the help of an example. Let's say you are going to build an e-commerce application. So in the e-commerce application, what are the real world entities? We having the customer, we having the product, we having the categories. So these are actually real world entity. So how these real world entities we represent in our code? Obviously we need to create the classes. You will create a class for customer, you will create a class for product, you will create a class for category also. And every real world object having attributes like customer ID, name, address, contact number. For product, it would be product ID, name, and description. So how these attributes we define in our code? In code, we define the properties. So within the customer class, you will define the customer ID, you will define the name, you will define the address. So all the properties we define over there. And when you're talking about a particular customer information, so obviously this customer class object we will create, and that object will hold the information about a particular customer, like customer ID 101, customer name is Mohan, address is Noira, and contact number is like something else. So object is a class which we are creating in our code that is containing actually properties. If you are looking at closely, how we will identify in our code which class is acting as an object, because obviously everything is class. So any class which having your properties is actually referred to as an object, is referred to represent a real world entity in the code. But when you're talking about the logic, obviously for logic also you will write a class. So let's take the same example of customer. So now this customer you are willing to add into the database. So obviously you will create a one more class, let's say customer bell class you will create, and there you will write some method, let's say add customer, remove customer, get customers, get customer by ID. So you are adding methods in the customer bell class, and obviously in each method you will write some logic so that a customer can be added into database, you can retrieve the customer from the database also. So that class is actually referred to as a logical class. So in simple language, a class which is containing a set of methods for doing something else is referred to as a logical class, or you can say class. But when a class having only properties is referred to as a real world entity, or you can say it's going to represent an object. So this is the thing you should understand between the object and class. So whatever the definition you learn about in the books, that is different in the practical way when you're going to understand at the code level. I hope now it's clear to you how to identify which one is an object in my code and which one is my logical class in my code. So this is about the data and logic management we are doing with the help of object and class. So if you will look at in the MVC pattern, so obviously in MVC pattern we are talking about model, view, and controller. So when we say model, so models are the domain objects in our application which we are using for holding the data, and the models can be created in data access layer, in business layer, in service layer, in presentation layer. It depends how many layers you are having in your application. So if you're creating a model in the DEL layer, it will refer to as data model. If you're creating a model in the presentation layer, it will refer to the presentation model. If you're creating a model in the service layer, it can be a service model. It depends whether you are creating the object in that particular layer or not. So models are the domain objects. So when you're talking about the controller, so controller we create for writing our presentation logic. So whatever the views we will have in our application, obviously you will define some controls over there. Let's say you have defined a login page and you are having a submit button. So after filling the value in the login page, obviously the user will click on the login button. And when the user will click on the login button, that value go to the server side. And where we will handle that code? So that code we will handle within a controller class with the help of the action. So controller is a class where we define the presentation logic, and model is a class where we represent a real life object. Simple. And DOM is here we define on a view page. So this is about the MVC pattern mapping we are having here when we are building our web application. So MVC pattern is actually helping us to manage our web application main components. So I hope now it is clear to you what is MVC pattern and how it is helping us to manage our web application component. Now let's proceed to the next slide here. So model, I already explained to you, models are the domain objects, and in different layers you can define the different models over there. And based upon the models, based upon the layers, so models can be data models and models can be the business model. So if you will look at in our code right now, this is my project and here I'm having a models folder. So what I can do here, I can create a model. So what I'm doing here, I'm just going to create a presentation model, or you can say I'm just going to create here a view model. So I'm adding here a class for my login view model. So here I'm just going to create a login page. You can see here, this is my login view model, and what I'm doing here, I'm just adding here two properties. So one property I'm just going to add here for username, because I will take the username, and another property I'm just adding here for password here, so that we can define the password. It's a property which I'm adding here for password. So these are the two properties we are having. One is for username and another one is here for password. I have specified over here. So this is the view model I have created, which I will use to create my login page. Similar way, you can create a model in your data Excel layer as well to represent a database table. So that would be the data model over here, simply. So now let's talk about the view. So we can create here the different types of views in our MVC core application. So we having the standard view. So standard view we create to define a static page. Let's say you are willing to display some static information like about us page, contact us page. So such information you can display with the help of the standard view. The second one is here is strongly typed view. So strongly typed view having a dependency on a model class. So whenever you are creating a view based upon a model class, that will known as the strongly typed view. The example is here, let's say we having a login page. So obviously login page we create based upon a model class, let's say login view model. So in that case, that login view is connected to your login view model. So that's why it is a strongly typed view. And strongly typed view we commonly create in our ASP.NET MVC application. The reason is whenever we are taking the input from the end user, so before taking the input from the end user, we validate the things on the client side as well as server side. So in that case, the strongly typed view help us to write our validation logic so that we can validate the data on the client side as well as server side over there. The third option is here the partial view. So partial view we can create in our ASP.NET core application to create the reusable UI component. Sometime it happens, we are willing to reuse the menu. We are willing to use the footer. We are willing to use the right sidebar or like left sidebar in our application across all the pages. So in that case, with the help of partial view, that reusable UI component can be created. Even starting from ASP.NET core, we having the view components also. So view components you can use in ASP.NET core to create the dynamic views. The dynamic partial view we can create here with the help of view components in ASP.NET core. The example is here, let's say you are willing to render the number of comments corresponding to an article. So those number of comments you can render with the help of the view components in ASP.NET core. The another example for the view components can be here. Let's say you're willing to show the number of categories which are available in the database. So those number of categories we can display with the help of view components. So whatever you are willing to render from the database dynamically on the web page, so that thing we can render here with the help of view components over here. So this is about the view component simply. The next one is here, we having the layout. So when you're talking about designing the website, so designing the website layout, So obviously we need to define a consistent look and feel for the application. We define a consistent header, we define the consistent footer, we define the consistent right sidebar and the left sidebar. It depends upon your design. So that consistency can be achieved here in our ASP.NET Core application with the help of layout. In web form, we say it as a master page. Even in MVC 5 also, we say it layout. So these are the different views we can create in our ASP.NET Core application. Now let's understand which one is the standard view, which one is partial view, and which is layout in our code. If you look at the code, we already having the few views created automatically when we created our ASP.NET Core application by default over there. So if you look at here, we having a privacy page and we having an index.cshtml page. So these two pages are actually here for standard view. So these are the example of standard view over here. And if you look at in the shared folder, we having a underscore validation script partial. So this is the example of partial view. So this is a static partial view because we having some static information. And if you will look at, we having underscore layout. So this is acting as a layout page because here we define a consistent header. We define a consistent footer. So across the application, this consistent header and footer we can show over here. And here if you will look at, we having the @renderBody method. So this @renderBody method is responsible to render the content of the page based upon the routing. Because in ASP.NET Core also, we having the routing. So based upon the requested route, the content of the page will be rendered. So this @renderBody method is responsible to render the content of the page based upon the routing. So this is the example of layout we are having over here. So far we have not created any strongly typed view. So strongly typed view we have to create. So what I'm going to do here, I'm just going to create a strongly typed view for the login purpose. So let's create here a controller. I'm just going to create a controller named as account. So I'm just going to create a MVC empty controller. It's a account controller. Just click on that button. So you can see using the scaffolding to generating the code. So if you know about the scaffolding, so scaffolding is a code generation technique and scaffolding is everywhere. Whether you are using Angular, whether you are using MVC 5, ASP.NET Core, everywhere we having the scaffolding technique to generate the code for us to simplify our life. So same thing is happening over here. We are just creating a view page with the help of scaffolding techniques available in Visual Studio. Okay, so finally my account controller has been created and what I'm doing, I'm just defining here a login page. I'm just defining here the login action and for my login action, I'll get a login page. So if you look at right now, we don't have any folder with the name account. So what happens, whatever the controller name you are having, corresponding to controller, we having a view folder also. If you look at, we having the home controller and we having the home folder. Similar way, now we having the account controller and corresponding to the account controller, we have the account folder also. That would be generated automatically. So let's do right click at the login action. I'm just going to add a view here, login. And here you can select here the template because in Visual Studio we having the various templates which you can use to create or you can say to generate the code. And these are the scaffolding templates available. So you can use a create template, delete template, details template. So various templates are available. So right now I'm not willing to use any templates. I'm using here the empty template and I'm not passing here any model. So model need to pass only whenever you are using one of the templates, a create template when you're using, so you need to pass a model class so that we can generate the text boxes based upon the model class you have passed. So right now I'm using here without model. So now let's click on the add button. So it will create a login page and it is a empty view it will create for us. It's created here, and still it is a standard view. It's not a strongly typed view. If you're willing to create a view as a strongly typed, so what you need to do at the top label, let's add the reference of the model on which you're willing to create it. So I'm just going to create this view based upon a login view model. It's a login view model. This model class I added the top label. Now here I can create a HTML form, and we can define the text box for username. We can define the text box for password also. So let me use here form tag, and here I'm just using your ASP dissection. Define the action name, let's say login. And guys, here I'm using here tag helper syntax. So in ASP.NET Core, we having the tag helpers. So this ASP dash action is coming from the tag helper syntax. So tag helpers are new to the ASP.NET Core. So if you already know the AngularJS, if you already know the ReactJS, like similar JavaScript framework, so there you will find out already the people are using such syntax. In AngularJS, we using the ng-controller, ng-model to extend the capability of our existing HTML markup. The similar way, the tag helper we can directly inject into the pure HTML markup tag. So the form is HTML tag where we just added the ASP.section tag. And here we define the action name. Similar way, I can define the controller name also. So ASP.controller, it would be here, account is my controller. So the benefit of tag helpers is here. If you are working with a UI developer, like if you are working as a designer, so from the designer, like from the UI developer end, we always retrieve our web page design in pure HTML. So now you are willing to inject your Rhesus index. So if you are using the MVC 5, in MVC 5 we don't have the tag helper. There we use HTML helpers. So HTML helpers are the extension method of HTML helper class. So using the @HTML, we can access, or you can say we define all the HTML helper methods over there. Let's say HTML dot text box, HTML dot action link, HTML dot text box 4. So such we having the various extension method available on the HTML helper class. Same are also supported in ASP.NET Core because of backward compatibility. Because it can be the case you are willing to migrate your existing MVC 5 application to ASP.NET Core. So that is possible. So the Microsoft team didn't discontinue the support of the HTML helpers. They still supporting the HTML helpers because so that you can easily migrate your MVC 5 application to the ASP.NET Core. But here I'm not showing you the HTML helper syntax. I'm just going to show you here tag helper. So that's why I just mentioned here action name as login and controller name as account. It's simple. Now similar way, I can define here a div where I will define the username. So I'm just using here username as a text. Let me define here input, and it would be here input type text. And here let me use here ASP.4. So again ASP.4 is a tag helper. And here what are the public properties we will have in this login view model class? So those properties will available, and for one of the property I can define this text box. So it would be here user name. So let me see what the properties are available. It's a user name. So it would be here for username. I'm creating this text box. Similar way, let's create here for password also. And let's add a submit button also. So I'm defining here password, and it would be here ASP.4. It is password, and input type also it is here password. Now here in this step, let's add a submit button so that we can submit the form data on the server side. I'm defining here input type. Our value would be here login for my submit button, and type I'm defining here submit. And we already using here Bootstrap 4. So if you're willing to use here Bootstrap 4 button style like Bootstrap 4 text box CSS, so you can specify here. Let's say you can define here class equal to btn dash primary. Even at the text box level also you can define the class here directly. So now the things are simplified. So if you are working on a existing template which you have purchased from somewhere else, so there you can easily integrate the Razor syntax without changing your HTML markup a lot. In MVC 5, we need to change that markup text boxes entirely because we don't have such a style over there. But here it's going to simplify the things. So now in ASP.NET Core, the things are more easier with the help of Tag Helper. Even whatever the UI developer, like designer, is working with you, that person can also understand this syntax, because in HTML helper the things, the syntax cannot be understood by a person who is not aware of the Razor syntax. But here it can be understood easily. So this is the benefit of the Tag Helper. So Tag Helper advantages explained to you and why you should use it. Okay, that's great. So we have done with the strongly typed view over here, and partial view we already having over here. If you look at, we having a shade folder where we having the underscore validation script partial. So this partial view you can add wherever you need to use the jQuery validation library to validate the user input on the client side. So whenever I need to validate the user input on the client side, there this library I can use it. So if you look at here on this underscore layout page, we having a section, we having a section for script. So usually this section we use whenever we are willing to inject a script from a child view page on the master page. So later on I will explain this concept. Let me first complete what are the various type of views we created. So we created the standard view, we created the strongly typed view, we already having the partial view, we already having the layout page. So this is the way these different views now we created in our application already. Now one of the example I'm just going to show you here. If you're willing to create your own partial view, how you can create. So what I'm doing here, I'm just going to create a partial view for my header. I'm just adding a view here. Now define the view name, let's say underscore header, and this would be my partial view. So I just added here the view name as underscore header. So underscore usually we define before the view name because it just a naming convention we are using over here. So by looking at the underscore as a prefix, we understand here this is the file we are using at more than one places. So usually when we define the layout page, we use underscore, and the layout also as a name we use over there, so that we can understand out, say this file is for layout page. And with partial view also we use underscore so that we can okay, this is a file which we are reusing it at more than one place. This is the only logic behind it. So now what I'm doing here, I'm just going to copy this header markup. So let me copy here the complete header tag. This header tag I just cut from here. I'm just putting in my underscore header. So now wherever you are willing to use this header, you don't need to do the same code again and again. Just keep in a separate file named as underscore header, and with the help of partial tag I can define the file name which I'm willing to render over here. So this is a partial tag I'm just using here, and just define here the view name as underscore header. So by default you will look for this underscore header file. What are the action we are serving over here are in the shade folder. So in the shade folder it is available. So from the shade folder it will render. but if it is available in a specific location. So the location path you can mention over here with the file extension. So let's say if it is a part of the account folder, you can mention here account, like shellash account shellash underscore header.css.html. So this way also you can define it simply. So this is the way I just added here a underscore header partial view. So next one is here controller. So when you're talking about the controller, so controller is a C# class or VB.NET class if you are talking about the ASP.NET MVC. And a controller contains the action method and a controller contains the regular method. So how you will identify which is the action method, which is the regular method? So if you will look at in this account controller, we having the login page. So this login page is actually acting as the action method. So to understand which method is my action method and which method is my regular method, it can be understood here with the help of pretty much simple example. Any method within your controller class which is responding to the user action or user activity will refer to as an action method. So let's say in our case, if user is requesting the account shellash login URL, so this method will respond to that user action. So that's it is an action method. Now let's say similar way, I can add here a one more method. So I'm adding here a method, let's say for adding two numbers. So I'm adding here, let's say public integer add, let me use here integer x comma integer y, and here I'm just returning the sum of x plus y. So here x value I'm passing here 5, y value I'm passing here 2. So whenever it's responding to this user action, because when the user requesting this page, it will refer to as action method. But if it is not responding to the user action, it would be the regular method only. So that can be done here if I will decorate this section as known action attribute. This is the one option over here. Just decorate that method with the known action attribute. Or you can do one more thing here. Just change the access modifier from public to private or protected. In that case also, it would be the known action method. That means you can call it only inside this controller class. You cannot call it from the outside. So this is the way how the methods you can identify whether it is a regular method, whether it's an action method. So this is about the controller I explained to you in our ASP.NET core application. Now let's talk about what are the various result types are available, like what are the various action result we are having. So in ASP.NET core, we having the iAction result interface that is used by the action result class, and further the action result class is used by the various other subclasses like redirect result, content result, redirect to root result, file result, view result, partial view result. So we having the various type of result classes which can be used to return the different types of result. So let's say if you are willing to return here the data is a JSON format, so you can use here JSON result. If you are willing to return here a view, so we can use here view result. If you are willing to return here a partial view, we can use a partial view result. If you are willing to return a file, let's say PDF file or like any other file, we can use a file result. And if you are willing to go from one action to another action, so we can use here a redirect result or redirect to root result. And the same classes also you have in MVC 5 also, and same classes we have in here also. So if you will look at the action label, there we define the action return type as either iAction result, either action result over there. Because if you will look at in this result classes hierarchy, all the classes directly and indirectly are inheriting the action result class. And the action result class is using the iAction result interface. So iAction result interface is new to the ASP.NET Core. It was not in MVC 5, but here it is. So if you're willing to create your own custom result type, so there what you can do, the action result interface you can implement, and you can define your own custom action result also. It's up to you. If you're willing to create your own custom result, that can be done here by implementing the action result class. So you might be thinking here where we use the action result and where we use the specific return type. So this thing should be divided based upon the return type of your action. If you look at in our case, this is my login page, and I know I'm just using this action to render a login view. So here, if you will look at this return view method, this return view method is returning here view result class instance. And here I'm sure I'm just going to render a view. So as a best practice, what you should do, you should use here view result as a return type. Here you should not use the action result, because action result is perfectly valid when your method is returning the multiple types of result. So there can be one case it is returning the view, there can be the another case it can go to the some other page. So in that case, you should define a common result type. So that is here action result class, and that is here action result class. So if I will define here its post method, in the post method we will have two conditions. The first condition would be here. So first of all, let me receive here the data. So I will receive here login view model. This one I'm receiving over here. So this is the login view model class I'm just importing over here. And before processing the received input, we should check the model state. So I'm just going to use a model state dot valid. So I'm just going to check here with what are the input we are receiving from the end user that are perfectly valid as per our expectation. Now here you should write the code to process this data. So right now I didn't cover the entity framework core, which I will cover in tomorrow's session. So here I'm not writing any code. I'm just writing here the code redirect to some other page. So it would be here redirect to action. Action would be here, let's say message. And you can define the action name also. Sorry, the controller name also. So if you will look at the return type of this method is redirect to action result. And the return type of this method is view result. So here we having like this way, return, redirect to action, and redirect to, this is the view. So in this case, I'm getting the error now, because this method return type is view result. So expectation is here, it should return the specific type. But how we can handle the return type for this action method and the return type of this view method? That should have a common one. So that can be done here now using the iAction result interface. So here it is perfectly valid to define its I as iAction result, because iAction result is also implemented by the view result class, and it is also implemented by the redirect to action result class. It's a common interface. So as per the interface and the class understanding, you should know a class object we can pass as a reference to the interface instance. So same thing is happening over here. So these two different classes, object we can pass as a reference to this iAction result instance. It's perfectly valid here. So this is about the action result. Here you should know. So we have done here the MVC pattern along with I explain here tag helper as well as the action result. And if you look at how the complete of a workflow is working here. So let's say you are requesting a URL, let's say domain.com/product/edit/1. So this is the way how the flow will work over here. So what are the requests you are receiving? The request will be handled by the controller. Then this controller will process this request with the help of model. And what are the result is prepared? That result it will render on the view page. So this is the flow of the request we are having in our ASP.NET Core application. And sometime you will find out we create the view based upon a model class also. But every time it is not mandatory. You should create the view based upon a model class because view can have its independent existence. It is not mandatory to create the view based upon a model class. So when the product will open its in edit mode, so basically the user will start the interaction from the view page. So let's say user has entered some value in the text boxes. Let's say user has updated the product price. Now the user will click on the update button. So when the user will click on the update button, the data will go to the server side and update the things to database and do the things over there. So if you will look at how the complete flow is working in our ASP.NET MVC application, so this is the way how the flow is working over there. So user first interaction start from the controller, and what are the result is prepared by the control action and down to the view. Then the user start interacting with the view page, and what are the result is what are the changes has done by the user, those will notify it to the controller. And finally, on the same view or on the different view, we specify like the data has been updated successfully. So this is the way how the communication is happening in our ASP.NET Core application simply. So this is the complete flow you should know over here simply. So I just explained here the ASP.NET Core application perfectly over here. And here if you will look at, we already created all the types of views and control action also explained. Let me show you here how we can change the startup page or application. So here if you will find out, we having a use endpoints method. So in the use endpoints method, you can define the different patterns for our application. So if you will look at, this is my default root name, and here I define the controller as home and action as index. So here, this is just equivalent to the default value we having at the method level. If remember, we having a way in the C# method, we can define the parameter with the default values. So if you will not pass any value to those method parameters, so those default values would be used. Similar way here, when I will run my application first time, so there we are not passing any controller name, there we are not passing any action name. So automatically it will look for the home controller and the index action so that it can serve our application home page. Or you can say it is the startup page for our application. So that's why what happens in ASP.NET Core application, even in MVC5 application, so you will find out we having the first controller named as home. And there you will find out we having the action name as index. But it is not mandatory you should have the only home controller as a home page. You can define any controller, you can define any action over here, so that whenever you will run it, that particular controller action it automatically enter as a home page. So what I can do in my case, I can mention here account as a controller name, and action name I can define here as login. So now when I will run my application, it automatically open the account controller login action. So the account controller login action, it will show us as a home page for our application simply. Okay, if you will look at here, it is showing us the ambiguous match exception. So the reason is here, we are getting here ambiguity. The reason is here, we having a two action with the name as login. And by default, any action we can call by using the get request. But here, one action we should restrict to the get request, and one action we should restrict to the post request. So just decorate it with HTTP post so that this action I can use only for get request, and this action I can use here for making the post request. Now let's run the code to resolve the ambiguity between these two actions. So now it will run fine without an issue. That ambiguity has been resolved. after decorating the SIG connection with HTTP POST attribute over there. So you can see here, it's render my login page. I'm having the username, I'm having the password as a text box. Now when I will submit the value, let's me put here a breakpoint over there. Over here I'm passing here username, let's say Mohan, password let's say 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8. Now just click on the login button and this value is coming over here, and you can see in the model I'm getting the username, I'm getting the password. Now let's check it here whether it's valid or not. It's valid. Now it is redirecting me to the message action. And right now I don't have any action with the name message. So I need to create here a action with the name message. I don't have any message, so it will give us the error like message view does not, message action is not available. You can see it's giving us 404 error because I know we don't have any action with the name message. If we will define the action with the name message, so we will not get any error over here with that name. Now let's for the message add a view over here to fix it. So here don't create it partial view, we should create here as a standard view over there. So it's adding here a message, and here the difference between the partial view and the normal view will find out. Only I'm just defining here the view data and title. I'm using here, let's say view data and title. I'm just giving over here. It is here, let's say message, and here also I'm just defining here h1 message. This way I define. So now it will render it properly when I will redirect to it there. So guys, here as per the today plan, I just complete all the topics over here. I hope you enjoyed this session and will take it further to learn the ASP.NET Core. Thank you. Bye-bye.